researchers are trying to better understand the biology of stress and the many ways that toxic stress can affect a child's health. Stephanie Tsai has a report produced by Yahoo News about how frequent or prolonged adversity for a mother could affect the development of the baby in the womb.
When I met Lisa Thompson, like me, she was 5 months pregnant.
So you're due
December 5th.
Which is the same exact day that I'm due. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Lisa is 18 years old and 6 months earlier had been homeless.
How have you been doing as far as the stress of pregnancy?
I've had a lot of depression, a lot. So me and the dad kind of, he's happy about it. He says he's going to be there. I'm worried that he's not going to be there.
Did you think you would be doing it on your own?
No. I mean, I know my mom did it on her own when she was pregnant with me, but it's kind of scary because I don't want my baby to have life like that. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
My dad wasn't there when I was born. And basically that's all I know.
Researchers now believe poverty can begin in the womb if a mother is exposed to toxic stress.
When we are stressed, our heart rate goes up, our blood pressure goes up. Stress hormones get released in our bloodstream. Toxic stress is when those systems are activated most of the time.
Dr. Jack Shonkoff, a renowned expert on early childhood development, heads the Center on the Developing Child at Harvard University.
Toxic stress is not about the cause of the stress. It's the biological response to the stress. And an environment that is fraught with stresses affects gene expression. It affects how some genes turn on or turn off.
In utero? And
from the moment of conception until the moment you die.
In West Virginia, I've met several moms in an effort to understand how the stresses of poverty might affect them, their children, and even their unborn babies.
So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own.
At a food pantry held monthly at Hope United Methodist Church, I meet Kristen.
I'm filling the bag and I will be over to get you. I'm in Willing, so I'll be right over.
Can I get two of these, one for me and one for him?
She asks that we not use her last name, but shares a life story seemingly fraught with stress.
This is my daughter, Skylar, one of three. I have a 10-year-old and a 13-year-old. I got pregnant at 16. My mother and father were both addicts and alcoholics, and I had a rough childhood.
She won't talk to new people.
Okay, this is him.
Hello? I'm at a church thing.
So clearly you're still struggling financially.
Trying to get away from an abusive guy.
If you don't believe me, you can talk. Am I at a church right now?
Yes, she is.
Can you just tell us a little bit about the stresses you were going through? I mean, obviously
I was on Subutex when I was pregnant with her.
What is that? That's for
to get off opiates.
Oh yeah. Okay.
This is her dad calling. Okay. So I'm really sorry, but you know, I've got to go pick him up from work.
Okay.
But she had had withdrawals, and I went through postpartum depression. I was alone. I didn't have any support. My mom lives in Tennessee. I don't have a lot of family. Mm-hmm. And my mom wasn't the greatest mom, so I strive to be what she wasn't.
Bye.
Say bye.
Bye.
We have studied resilience in the face of poverty. One of the most important predictors of good outcomes in the face of adversity is the presence of at least one reliable, responsive, protective relationship with an important person. It can be very often as a parent, it can be another family member, a grandparent.
Shonkoff says this new biological understanding suggests breaking the poverty cycle begins with pregnant moms and the right kind of support.
We're already increasing the likelihood that next generation will do better.
The science may be new, but the national organization Nurse Family Partnership has been putting it to practice for nearly four decades.
Okay, we are headed out for our first visit.
Nurses like Lori Rogers in Montgomery, Alabama, pay home visits to first-time mothers, providing medical checkups and helping them set goals.
One of the things about Nurse Family Partnership is to make sure that, hey, we're asking, what do you want to do with your life? What's important to you?
Hey! Good morning.
Good morning. We're going to sit over here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Look at this butterfly. Typically, our visit consists of asking how they've been since we've been last here, whether they've been healthy, or I try to weigh Aubrey. I might get some measurements on her. We typically talk about Latrita, how's her job going? Well, this is an updated job list. I thought I'd give you this and just see. There might be something there. Look at the bunny.
The new science says doing the type of thinking involved in goal setting actually changes the brain, increasing executive function, which is a key to societal success.
When the work is done well, it helps to change brain wiring so that the individuals can basically become the navigators of their own lives and can.
Beth Babcock is head of a program based in Boston called Empath, which uses the latest neuroscience to coach families toward better outcomes.
You know, we're seeing families that when we work with them for 3 years or more are almost doubling their income.
This book will be yours, so you can write.
The real process of helping people move out of poverty is the process of standing beside and helping them see themselves and their future in a different way.
In a sense, it comes down to love.
I love you.
Providing love may counter the toxic effects of poverty-related stress, a surprisingly low-tech way to address what advanced brain science has revealed. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Stephanie Tsai.
And to watch the complete documentary, go to yahoo.com/babybrain.